Good morning. Heard a story about a guy who was walking through the woods, and this guy probably drank a little more than he should have, and he was kind of stumbling through the woods and came across a preacher down in the river, and the preacher was baptizing people. And the man stumbled into the water and come up, and he bumped against the preacher, and the preacher, surprised, turned around. And the preacher did what was coming naturally. He said, "Sir, are you ready to find Jesus?" He says, "Yes, I am." He says, "Great." And he grabs him and he throws him under the water, brings him back up. And he says, "Brother, have you found Jesus?" And the man says, No, I haven't found Jesus." And the guy was a little bit surprised. So he grabbed him again, dunked him again, held him under a little bit longer that time, brought him back up and said, "Brother, have you found Jesus?" He said, No, I haven't found Jesus." And the preacher was really just, he didn't know quite what to do, so he grabbed him one more time and threw him under and held him under about 30 seconds this time until his legs started flailing and his arms started going back and forth. Brought him up and said, "For the love of God, man, have you found Jesus?" And the guy wiped the water off his face, says, "No, are you sure this is where he fell in?" Well, somewhere between the man and the preacher, there was a disconnect. They were on totally different pages looking for totally different things in the same situation. Well, today I want us to think about, are we on the same page with God? There's sometimes it's not too unusual for us to have one thing in our mind, thinking about what this is the way it should be, and this is surely the way God wants it to be. And then lo and behold, we find that it's not that way at all. God had totally something different in mind. Well, as we continue our journey through the book of Acts, as we've been looking at the acts of God and the response of men, today we come upon what I would call a pivotal section in the book of Acts, where God does something amazing again that changes the direction of the whole, really, New Testament. It's one of those things that it's easy sometimes to get just kind of gloss over and skip on over and not really think much about it. But I want us to take pause today as we look at Acts chapter 10 and 11. And it's one of those passages you really need to get the whole story. So up on the slide, we don't have a slide. All right. Well, I'm going to read a bunch of different, they're working on that, a bunch of different passages. Not going to read it all. And every now and then I'm going to summarize some of that. But if you want to grab the Bible there in the pew in front of you, in the chair in front of you, there's the list. It's on page 110, 111. And those are the sections I'm going to be reading from, starting with Acts chapter 1. Here we go. "At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly. One day, about 3 in the afternoon, he had a vision. He distinctly saw the angel of God who came to him and said, 'Cornelius!' Cornelius stared at him in fear. 'What is it, Lord?' he asked. The angel answered, 'Your prayers and your gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He's staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea.'" So Cornelius does what the angel has asked him to do. He calls his men and he sends them off to Joppa to find this guy, Peter. Well, it picks up in verse 9, and here's what's going on. "About noon the following day, they were on their journey, and approaching the city, Peter went up to the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat, and while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven open and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles of the earth and birds of the air. Then a voice told him, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' 'Surely not, Lord. I have never eaten anything impure or unclean.' And the voice spoke to him a second time, 'Do not call anything impure that God has made clean.'" Now, this happened three times. And Peter was sitting there trying to figure it all out. And a knock came on the door. And at that time, the men from Joppa, or the men from Cornelius have arrived. Peter went downstairs. He met them. He let them in. They spent the night. And the next day, they all got together. And they went back to where Cornelius and his household was. Cornelius comes out to meet Peter. Then down in verse 27, this picks up what's going on. Talking with him, that's Cornelius, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. And he said to them, "You are well aware that it's against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But when God has shown me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objection. May I ask, why did you send for me?" And then Cornelius goes on and he tells him what happened. He told him about his dream and he told him about the angel appearing and told him all the things that occurred and how he had sent these guys to find him and bring him back. And then in verse 34, Peter replies this way. Then Peter began to speak to them. "Now I realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right." And see, I get the picture there when it says, "And now I realize," Peter had been trying to figure out what in the world did that vision mean the day before. This sheet that came down from heaven, full of all kinds of different creatures. What in the world? You ever had one of those things and you just can't get it out of your mind? What in the world? What in the world is going on? And then all of a sudden, boom, the light bulb comes on. He's in Cornelius' house. He said, "Now I got it. God has shown me that God's family is made up of everyone." So Cornelius sits down and Peter begins to share his testimony. He begins talking about Jesus and the things that Jesus did. And then he also tells about his own experience. He says, "You know, I was there in the resurrection and we saw Jesus after the resurrection and all these things." So Peter shares his testimony. He also shares the message of Jesus. And he comes to a point in his message where he says, "And even now, forgiveness of sins is only gained through believing in Jesus." And then much like at Acts chapter 2 when Peter was speaking and he came to a point and the people interrupted him, something else happened here. Verse 44. And while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. And the circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even to the Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, just as we have." So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. And that's the end of chapter 10. And we don't know how many days Peter was there, but somehow word gets back to Jerusalem. And that's where chapter 11 picks up. Maybe it was some of those men that went with Peter to Cornelius' house, said, "Hey, got to go." And they went back to Jerusalem and they could not wait to tell what had just happened. Chapter 11, verse 1, the action picks up. The apostles and the believers throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles who had received the word, of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him and said, "You went to the house of the uncircumcised men and ate with them." In other words, you went into a Gentile's house and ate with them. You've got to be kidding me. Because even Peter, that day when he went into Cornelius' household, reminded Cornelius, "You know it's against the law for me to be here. It was against the Jewish law for a Jew to even associate with a Gentile, let alone go in and sit down and share a meal with him." So Peter, from that point there in chapter 11, recounts everything that happens in chapter 10. Basically retells all the story of everything that goes on in chapter 10. And then in verse 15, this is what he says to him. He said, "Now as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them, and he came on them as he came upon us in the beginning. Then I remembered that the Lord had said, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized by the Holy Spirit. So God gave them the same gift he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. Who was I to think that I could oppose God? And here's the reaction. When they heard this, they had no further objections and praised God, saying, so then, God has granted even the Gentiles repentance unto life. Now, if you read the rest of the chapter on your own, you'll find that Barnabas and Saul get together. Saul's name is changed to the Apostle Paul. And the remaining of that chapter, they're in Antioch. And basically, that is a preparation for the rest of the book of Acts and the rest of New Testament history. Because from that point on, everything had changed. So what does all this have to do with us today? Ironically, we are the recipients of God's grace from that day. And what I mean by that, unless you are Jewish, all of us here who are not Jewish are Gentiles. And on that day, the opportunity to receive salvation through Jesus Christ was opened up to everyone who was not a Jew. That is transformational. That is what they would call a paradigm shift, a totally different way of thinking at that point in the history of the early church. But over the years, it's become somewhat easy for Christians to get the same mindset as the Jews. For us to think that it's only going to be people like us in heaven. We had John 3:16 read in three different languages besides English today. And if we had told you what those languages, some of you especially would have known the Spanish. But the Creole and the German, probably it was, you know, really foreign to us. And why did we do that? We did it intentionally to kind of remind us that we are not the only followers of Jesus in this world. And all through the world today, there have been people gathering and praising God in all kinds of different languages. And what is the one common denominator? It's the one common denominator is God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And that was made possible because of Acts 10 and 11. The acts of God and the response of man. So I want to share with you three thoughts today to just reflect on some of these things that we can gain from this passage in Acts chapter 10. And the first is simply this. God sees things that we sometimes miss. God sees things that in people that sometimes we miss. He sees people and we miss it. Let's take Cornelius, for example. God looked at the heart, but for the Jews, there were two major problems. One, he was a Gentile, and two, he was a Roman soldier. He was a man in authority. He was over 100 Roman soldiers. Now, if there were any two things that the Jews did not like, it was the Gentiles, who had no connection with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And a Roman soldier whom they despised because Rome had dominated their culture and their life, and they would like to see nothing more than for Rome to go away. And yet God goes to Cornelius, and he goes to Peter, and he brings the two together. How does that happen? Because God sees the heart of man, not just the outward appearances of man. We need to be careful what our mindset is. You see, God knew something about Cornelius that we maybe wouldn't have seen. His heart. Did you catch that? It said Cornelius was noticed by God because his gifts to the poor, his alms, were noticed by him. And he was a God-fearing man. It's the first time that phrase is applied to anyone in the New Testament, to the Gentiles in the New Testament. God fears in the New Testament, you'll find the phrase a couple of times, meant those who accepted that there was one God that made them different than everyone else in those days. And he tried to do what was right, but had not been totally immersed in the Word of God. But he was a man whose heart was right, and what he did got the attention of God. Now, it didn't stop there, because God had something else for him. And that's why Peter came, and that's why Peter preached, and that's why the Spirit came, that's why they were baptized in Christ. Even though Cornelius knew a lot of stuff, he was still just a little bit short of God's full plan of grace and salvation. It's too easy for us, if we're not careful, to get into the mindset that heaven's just going to be filled with white middle-class Americans who speak English. And that's not the way it's going to be. And we might think, well, surely God just wants us to reach out to decent human beings, right? Well, look at Scripture. God reached out to those that many times were rejected by men, by those that many would have just turned their backs on. Remember, Jesus goes into the graveyard on the east coast of the Sea of Galilee, and there is a man running through the graveyard screaming, and everyone in town just totally stayed away from this dude. And Jesus went up and changed his life. God sees things that we sometimes don't see. And we need to be ready to make sure we're not missing something that he sees. Second thing from this whole passage and this whole story is simply this. God wants us to open our eyes to see others as he does. Peter's vision of animals was quite interesting. Has that sheet lowered down, and it said there were all kinds of four-footed animals there. And there was all kinds of Jewish regulations on what kind of animals they could eat and what kind of animals they couldn't eat. And there were certain animals that they were forbidden from eating. And one of those, and you've probably heard this, was pork, okay, pig, because of the foot and how it was made. It said that is not the type of animal you see. That was unclean. So this happens three times, and this sheet is lowered down, and God says, Peter, get up and eat. And we think, well, I like pork. What's his problem? Hot dogs. I had pork ribs last night for supper. They were good. It would be like God lowering a sheet or a plate in front of you, and he brings a plate, and on that plate are cockroaches, scorpions, and grubs. And he says, eat. Now, you can eat those. You've all seen those reality shows where they've had to eat those gross things. You can eat cockroaches and scorpions and grubs without dying. But what would we think? No way. That's what Peter was going through. Oh, that is gross. Lord, I would never do that. And then Peter got it. Oh, yeah. That's not what he's talking about at all. He's wanting me to know that it's okay to accept all of his creation. We need to have our eyes open to see the world as God does. Think of some of the times Jesus saw things differently. He goes to the woman at the well. The disciples had gone into town, and he begins teaching or talking and then teaching to this woman. When the disciples come back from the town, in a distance, we kind of get what they're saying, and they're, look at that. He is talking to a woman, a Samaritan woman, in public, in the middle of the day. How in the world could he even do that? See, but what Jesus saw was someone who needed help and who needed hope. What the disciples saw was someone to be avoided. Totally different way of seeing things. Think of the woman caught in adultery. She was caught red-handed. And the Pharisees saw that as an opportunity to stone the lady to death. Someone that needed to be condemned. And what did Jesus see? Someone who needed forgiveness. Lepers. Back in those days, you were to do everything you could to avoid lepers. It was a skin disease. Actually, it's a disease of the nervous system that kills your nerve endings. And people, they would get injured and they wouldn't know they didn't get that they got injured because there would be no pain. And especially in those days when there was no antibiotics and things like that, many times their body parts would become so infected that would have to be amputated or they would fall off and the skin would turn a different color. And it was a terrible, terrible disease. In fact, if you're a Pharisee and you saw a leper come down the road, you had to go across the road on the other side, walk past this man. And it was required by the law for the leper to yell out, "Unclean, unclean," so that no one would touch them. So Jesus meets 10 lepers one day. And what does he do? He touches them and heals them. What Jesus saw was someone who needed to be healed. What everyone else saw was someone who to be disdained and avoided. We need to realize that God wants us to see people as He sees people. To see needs as He sees needs. This is key in the church. For us to be the church that God wants us to be. To see people as Jesus sees people. It's key when we talk about missions and who we're going to support and where they're going to go. It's key to see areas that need people to go to them. We support missions in Izmir, Turkey, a highly Muslim nation. We support a missionary in Germany, where God has been suppressed and the Christians there have not enjoyed the blessings that we have had for many years. We support people on the East Coast. I think, well, that's right here in America. Why in the world would we have to support something there? New England is the most unchurched area in America, statistically. We need to see the world as Jesus does. And even here in Bonita, we need to see the world as Jesus does. We're not all alike. We don't all come from the same background. We don't have all the same heritage. One of the things I love about our youth group here, of our kids, is just a mixture of kids that we have. I tell people it's like seeing a picture of heaven when you see a big picture of all the kids we have here. See, God, in Acts chapter 10 and 11, understood what the bigger picture was. And that leads us to the final thing to think about. And it's simply this. We must let the heart of God transform our hearts. There in verse 1 and 2 of the opening book of chapter 11, it was like, "I can't believe it. Peter, how in the world could you have done such a thing to go to the house of a Gentile?" But once Peter explained what had happened, and once he explained that God had acted, then the only thing they could do is respond, and they're in verse 18 again. When they heard this, they had no further objections, and they praised God, and they said, "So then, God has granted salvation also to those who believe in Him." They opened the door to the message of salvation. You know what occurred to me? Because I think this is what happened with the religious leaders, the new Christians. They didn't shed off all of their culture when they became Christians. They were still Jews, really, at heart. They still had everything that they had grown up with, and a lot of those mindsets and things were still there. But I realized that the way we see other people sometimes is dependent on how we see ourselves. And they had seen themselves as God's chosen people, and they couldn't imagine anyone else other than them being a part of things. And God opened their eyes there. I read this story. Maybe you've heard it. During the American Revolution, there was a man in civilian clothes. He was riding down the road, and he came up across a regiment of soldiers, and they were trying to repair a defensive barrier there. And there was a corporal on his horse, and he was barking orders at these soldiers and telling them how to do this and how to do that as he sat there and gave all these directions to these guys in a not so nice way. And the man that was riding by stopped and said, well, sir, why aren't you helping them? And the man indignantly said, sir, I am a corporal in this army, and these are mere soldiers. So the man on the horse got down off the horse. He was just wearing his plain clothes, and he stayed there until the soldiers had finished their task. And then that man went over to the corporal and said, sir, next time that your soldiers have a task that they cannot finish, go and get your commander-in-chief, and then I will come and help them again. And the story goes, it was George Washington who'd been the man who'd stopped and served. I can't help but to feel that God wants us to see the world as He does. And that what happened in Acts chapter 10 and 11 simply blew the doors off of the way the world was to be. Because from that point on, everyone was open to receive the gift of eternal life. May we be a people, may we be a church that sees the world and individuals as God does. Let's pray.